listening to the X-Zone Broadcast Network, www.xzbn.net. Radio's authority on the world of the paranormal and the science of parapsychology, celebrating 25 years of broadcasting. Broadcasting around the world and to the great beyond.
X-Zone Radio and TV show is largely an opinion talk show. All opinions, comments, or statements of fact expressed by Rob McConnell's guests are strictly their own and are not to be construed as those of the X-Zone Radio and TV show or endorsed in any manner by Rob McConnell, Relmar McConnell Media Company, the X-Zone Broadcast Network, its affiliated networks, stations, or employees.
All Hit Radio. Welcome to the X Zone, a place where fact is fiction and fiction is reality. Now, here's your host, Rob McConnell.
And welcome back, everyone. This is the X-Zone. I am Rob McConnell. We're coming to you from our broadcast center in Hamilton, Ontario, Canada, on the X-Zone Broadcast Network, the Mutual Broadcast Network, the Talkstar Radio Network, and in Europe on Radio X. My guest this hour is John Moore, and John is with the Ottawa Paranormal Research and Investigations. Their website is www.ottawaparanormal.com. And John has been investigating and researching the paranormal since 1995. His first experiences occurred in his family's funeral home when he was only 8 years old. Now, over the years, he has had countless encounters with paranormal activity and worked with many different groups as a freelance investigator all over Canada. He has always been a follower and a student of parapsychology. Now, in the summer of 2014, he decided to form Ottawa Paranormal Research and Investigations because he was sick of being on teams that were trying to imitate those they see on TV. Thank God somebody has sense in this business. Now, He used his knowledge and experience to help those affected by extreme paranormal activity. He is considered by some as a demonologist, though he prefers to think of himself as a paranormal investigator first and foremost. Currently, in addition to being the lead investigator for OPRI, he is the director of demonic investigations for Haunted North America Network, as well as director of assessment and investigations for the Holy Order of St. Michael the Archangel. He has spent years developing a network of like-minded teams throughout North America and beyond to help anyone, anywhere that contacts him in need of assistance, regardless of their situation or beliefs. Joining me now from Ottawa, Ontario, Canada, is John Moore. And John, welcome to the X-Zone.
Hi, Rob. Thanks for having me.
Wow. Dedicated, hardworking, and honest. Those are good traits to be in the paranormal community with, John. And I couldn't agree with you more that there are so many people who are watching these so-called reality shows that, in my opinion, are not showing the true work of paranormal investigators at all.
No, I couldn't agree more with you, Rob, on that. That was one of the biggest pet peeves I've always had. It's just people see these shows and they don't realize what goes in behind the scenes on those.
You know, I've been approached many times by television networks and members of the media to consult on shows. And 10 minutes into the discussion, and they don't like me anymore because I don't agree with the sensationalistic aspect that they want. You know, yeah, I know it's entertainment. Yeah, I know that you're fighting for ratings. Yeah, I know that you want to make money through advertisers. Yeah, I know that the bigger networks will give you a bigger payday. I understand that. But what about truth? What about credibility? What about integrity? What about honesty?
Absolutely. I mean, that's sadly what you see when you watch these shows. I mean, a lot of the time, a lot of the stuff you see on those is just edited in, right? I mean, there's no fault of the investigators themselves, honestly. I don't think they have anything to do with it. They're just doing what they do. It's the editing crews afterwards that do all that. I mean, currently we're filming our own here in the city of Ottawa,
right,
and we're having these same things with the production staff with our show as well. But, I mean, it comes with the business, right?
It does. Hey, listen, John, you and I have to take a short break. We'll be back shortly. X-Zonation, John Moore is our special guest. He is the lead investigator and founder of Ottawa Paranormal Research and Investigations. Their website, ottawaparanormal.com. And we'll both be back on the other side of this break as we continue here in the X-Zone from our broadcast center in Hamilton, Ontario, Canada. Don't go away. Afterlife expert Roberta Grimes was the first one to say that dying can be fun. Now her best-selling book, The Fun of Dying, is available in stores worldwide. So if you wonder whether death ends life, how it feels to die, or what heaven might be like, The Fun of Dying was written for you. And if you have always been afraid of death, or if you worry that your life has no meaning, let The Fun of Dying ease your fears and bring new meaning to your life. Nothing said in The Fun of Dying is based on the teachings of any religion. Instead, Roberta draws on evidence to explain how death happens, how it feels, and what comes next. A lot of the best death-related evidence was produced in the first half of the 20th century. When it is put together with recent discoveries, it tells a consistent and amazing story. Roberta Grimes blogs and answers questions at robertagrimes.com. Her wonderful book, The Fun of Dying, is available on Amazon and at stores worldwide wherever books are sold. You're listening to the X-Zone Broadcast Network, www.xzbn.net.
While science pursues fact, magic accesses the quantum level, bridging random facts to form truth. As long as science and magic remain separate and polarized, the truth cannot be known. I'm Wilda Wiecka. Join me on the Science of Magic radio program dedicated to unification and evolution of consciousness. During each episode, I'll be speaking with experienced and respected scientists and mystics. From astrologers to astronomers, from medical doctors to shaman, the scientific method to dowsing and intuition, we will weave together information from seemingly divergent practices to promote unity and enlightenment. Join me, Wilda Wiecka, and the Science of Magic right here on the X-Zone Broadcast Network. For more information, visit www.thescienceofmagic.net.
Star began to demonstrate a metaphysical connection to the spirit world as a little girl. Her family noticed the connection, but it was a great-grandmother who told the family that Linnea was indeed gifted. The great-grandmother, who was also gifted, felt that Linnea had indeed inherited these attributes. It has been noticed that oftentimes such things are passed down through the generations. Linnea was also born with a caul, a thin white membrane across a newborn's face. Legend has it that if the baby is born with this caul, the child will have second sight, or what we call psychic abilities. Linnea Star does past, present, and future, and has the gift of prophecy. It is written within scriptures that if you were able to give factual information, and prophecies indeed come true, the gift indeed comes from the divine realm. Linnea Star does large interactive groups as well as private gatherings. For more information on Linnea Star or to contact Linnea for a one-on-one consultation, visit her website at www.linneastar.com. That's www.linneastar.com.
And welcome back to the X-Zone, everyone. John Moore is our guest this hour. He is lead investigator and founder of the Ottawa Paranormal Research and Investigations. He's the director of Demonic Investigation, Haunted North America Network, and the director of assessment for the Holy Order of St. Michael the Archangel. His website, ottawaparanormal.com. You know, during the intro, I was talking about your first experience with the paranormal when you were 8 years old in your family's funeral home. Can you tell us about that experience?
Certainly. Basically, it was the end of the evening. My dad was cleaning up after I believe it was a wake that had happened that evening, and I was just waiting in the lobby for him to finish up. Mm-hmm. You know, we lived right next door to the funeral home, so it was nothing uncommon for me as a boy to be there to just help my dad and hang around. And basically, at the top of the in the landing, there's a staircase that goes down to where we would have the showcase for the caskets and things that people would use for wake. And while standing there, I saw what appeared to me to be an older gentleman standing at the bottom of the stairs. It was dark, so I couldn't really tell if he was see-through or anything like that.
Right.
But at the same time, this gentleman smiled at me, then just walked off to the side, like into an area that I couldn't see. I said hi, and my dad came out asking, who was I talking to? So I explained to him I was talking to the man downstairs. Now, at this point, the building's locked, everyone's already left, so my dad is thinking somebody got lost, so he goes around and starts looking for them. It turns out he went through the entire building, never found a soul. And I found out probably, I think it was a year and a half later, mm-hmm. that the person I saw was actually my great-grandfather, who had died when I was 3 months old. He was the original founder that actually built the funeral home himself. So it was just kind of strange to find him hanging around.
The fact that you were, you know, you were part of a family funeral home, do you think that had anything to do with your quest to get into the paranormal, to find out what's behind the curtain?
I honestly do, actually. My great-grandfather showed himself to him. He actually used to say that, you know, the paranormal was real.
Yeah.
And this thing, these things are always out there. He said they leave, his view on it was they leave us alone because as funeral directors, we were keepers of the dead in his eyes. Now, nobody knows if he was joking about that or anything more on that. Like I said, he died when I was 3 months old, so unfortunately I never got the chance to actually speak to him about it. But yeah.
So what made you decide to begin investigating the paranormal, and how old were you when you decided, you know what, this is it, this is real, I want to find out more?
Well, when I was 15 in 95, we moved into a house that was, it was known as a haunted house in my hometown. There had been almost 1,500 sightings of the previous owner, whose name was Mr. Farmer. He was always seen standing in the picture window, just looking out over the river. And one day I fell asleep on the couch. I woke up probably around, I think, midnight, 1 a.m., somewhere in that range. I looked over, and sure enough, there's Mr. Farmer standing in the window. And that, coupled with my experience when I was 8, just rekindled my interest in it and got mm-hmm. me thinking, you know, what's going on? What else is out there?
Sure.
And it's just from there, it got me looking into what I could in books and what I could find online. Because, you know, in 95, there wasn't very much out mm-hmm. there that was on the internet or anything. So,
So how haunted are most funeral homes?
Most of them do have some amount of activity going on. You have to think the amount of emotion that goes on in those places, all the loss, the sadness, the sorrow, all these things take their toll and all this energy gets built up. Mm-hmm. So you do see quite a bit of activity like that in a lot of these old buildings that were once funeral homes.
So over the years of being a paranormal investigator, John, what is the best piece of evidence you've ever collected?
The best piece we've ever collected was actually from a farmhouse in New Brunswick. It's up on our website. It's a video. I'm standing in a room along with three other investigators, all of us wearing black. And on the extreme right of the screen, you actually see a white form, almost like a, like we just see, it's like somebody's shoulder is going by in front of the camera. But and some people look at it and say, well, it's one of your people that moved, but mm-hmm. it wasn't one of us because we actually have a second angle, which is directly behind me at 90 degrees to the camera. You see all four of us and nobody's moving at the moment when this is taken. So for us, that was a rather interesting moment. And at the same point, we actually got a hit on the ghost box, which it's not a tool I generally use and I'm not a fan of it myself, but there were no radio stations actually in the area we were using it. So to have a voice come through was actually quite something for us.
Well, you know, radio waves travel a far distance. You know, there were many cases in Montreal where on the corner of St. Catharines and Atwaters, you could actually tune in to Chum Radio in Toronto based on, depends on the weather, depends on the atmospheric conditions. In fact, many people who use CB radios are well aware of the word called skip. It's when a radio signal skips off the atmosphere, and there have been cases where people in Canada have been able to talk to people down in Texas on a skip. So, you know, that kind of thing with these boxes, I question the validity of them. But that's just me, and
well, I do agree with you completely on that. I mean,
yeah.
When you're listening to something like that, it goes back to the old theory of white noise.
Sure.
Where your brain is going to basically take what it's hearing
yep.
and try to interpret it into something it can understand. So in doing that, it's going to make words. So that's 90% of what's going on. And when you're taking into account that these the ghost box cycles through different stations,
yeah.
you're getting words and things from different DJs and all kinds of things coming through. So just putting that mixed with what you're asking for and what you know about the location – your brain is automatically making you think, hey, this relates to this, so there you go.
You know, the ghost box of today is nothing new. It was actually, the technology was out in the 70s. In fact, the Bearcat company used to sell Bearcat scanners that were multi-band frequency scanners that you could actually set the rate to increase or decrease, and it would, you put in the frequencies that you wanted scanned. So when I hear some of these paranormal investigators talking about this new technology, I kind of chuckle. But it wasn't used for looking for spirits back then. It was used as a tool to listen into different frequencies, like airport frequencies, police frequencies, and so on. So it's funny how technology makes a revival every so often. What do you think the hardest part about being an investigator today is?
The hardest part today is easily the fact that you've got all these stigmas attached to what we do. Like, people, goes back again to the TV shows, people see that and they see, you know, investigators running around just yelling and mm-hmm. challenging thin air, and they think that's what it is. You're running around screaming at an empty room, daring something to come at you. And I mean, that's no way at all what we do. Another one is people would think that, you know, we put out flashlights and mm-hmm. wait for them to flash. We're using devices that technically are making assumptions and trying to call them scientific. So you have all these things working against you just because of how popular and how big it's gotten.
You know, one thing I find, John, about with most of these shows, they're very disrespectful towards those who had passed. Like you said,
challenging. Some of them, yeah. Not all. There are some out there where they are a little bit better towards it, but.
What was your most frightening case?
The most frightening case by far had to be the first case where we encountered a demonic entity.
Can you tell me about that?
In that case, we were contacted by a person here in Ottawa. And this person had been having a lot of activity. It started out with what most people would know as the shadow entity known as the Hat Man. Now, he's very common, probably the most common of the shadow entities that's out there. But this is what she had been seeing for some time. Mm-hmm. And so we came in, we were trying to figure out, you know, what's causing this, what's going on. We did all the usuals. We went through the house looking for mold, looking for EMF, infrasound, all the possible natural causes. In the end, we couldn't find anything. And during our course of our investigation, we caught a couple of interesting EVPs, one that sounds like a growl. And one of our psychics actually started reacting rather strangely and had to be removed from the premises once we brought in a rosary. So at that point, we began to see certain things that pointed us in that direction. And from there, we continued to investigate. And over time, we had a lot of rather strange, severe activity occur. One of the most severe I remember was watching this woman be almost lifted off the ground, and we could see a red mark, almost like a hand around her throat as she was choking.
Wow. Is there more demonic activity than people really realize?
That's a hard one to tell, because a lot of times the demonic will mimic mental illness. So it's hard to tell sometimes what's mm-hmm. mental illness and what's actually demonic entities. I mean, there's probably more happening than people realize that's being diagnosed as mental illness. But I wouldn't say like every person who's having like a mental breakdown or anything like that is possessed by a demon like some people would.
Right. But I guess what I was trying to get at, we rarely hear about demonic cases compared to the haunting cases.
Mm-hmm. Oh, there are a lot more of those demonic cases, but a lot of the people that deal with them, mm-hmm. we tend to keep those cases a little more private, just because those cases are rather severe. They deal with things that are very private and personal to the people involved. So you don't want to bring that out. And a lot of times, when dealing with the demonic, you know, right. people are going to say, well, show me proof. Some of the proof that you would be showing them can, in essence, be considered an invitation for these entities to actually come out and try to attach to someone else.
John,
so that's why you don't hear about that much.
John, stand by. You and I have to take our news break at the bottom of the hour. ExoNation, John Moore is our guest, lead investigator and founder of Ottawa Paranormal Research and Investigations. www.ottawaparanormal.com. And John Moore and I will be back on the other side of this news break as we continue here in the X-Zone from our broadcast center in Hamilton, Ontario, Canada. www.xzoneradio.com. And you can always send me an email to xzone@xzoneradio.com.
Wouldn't you love to know the secret to everything? Well then, meet Dr. Kimberly McGeorge and her cutting-edge breakthrough knowledge that combines science with possibility. Dr. Kimberly brings real-life answers and healing to those open to alternative solutions. She teaches solution-based programs and classes that will change all areas of your life forever. Specializing in conscious creation, intuitive readings, and energy medicine, you can rapidly shift health, relationships, business, and money and abundance challenges quickly. Receive her best-selling book, Secret to Everything, at no cost by going to secrettoeverything.com/X-Zone. That's right, transformation can start now. Just go to secrettoeverything.com/X-Zone and receive Dr. Kimberly's book for free.
You're listening to the X-Zone Broadcast Network, www.xzbn.net. Thomas Jefferson was a Burgess of 27 when he met Martha Wale Skelton, a 22-year-old widowed heiress who was fondly called Patty by her family. They were married on January 1, 1772, and they took up residence in a cabin on the building site on top of a Virginia mountain that Thomas had named Monticello. As Thomas and Patty slowly built their first version of the great house at Monticello, the Revolutionary War was heating up. Patty, with difficulty, bore five children, but only two girls survived. Thomas's political career developed to the point where he was often away from home. But after he authored and signed the Declaration of Independence in Philadelphia, he resolved never again to leave his wife. He was elected the governor of Virginia, just as that state became the Revolution's last battleground. The Revolutionary War ended in 1781, and Thomas gladly retired altogether to
my family, my farm, and my books.
But Patty continued to want to bear her treasured husband a son, and late in the summer of 1782, she died of kidney failure at the age of 33, 4 months after having born yet another girl. Thomas was so devastated by her death that he never remarried. He mourned her for the rest of his life, even as he helped to frame the peace in France and then became the first Secretary of State, the second Vice President, and the third President of the United States. This story is true. Thomas Jefferson was such an obsessive letter writer and record keeper that we know where he was and what he was doing nearly every day of his adult life. Every significant thing he says in My Thomas comes from his contemporary writings. My Thomas by Roberta Grimes is now available at Barnes & Noble, Costco, Target, Books A Million, Hudson Booksellers, Kmart, Walmart, Sam's Club, Walgreens, CVS, and online at Amazon.com. You can visit Roberta Grimes online at www.robertagrimes.com.
The scientist and the mystic have been on an age-old, relentless search with one thing in common. They seek truth. Their paths converge in the 40,000-year-old practice of shamanism, an ancient science delving to the quantum level of life, facilitating healing, manifestation, and evolution. I'm Gwilda Wiecka, the founder and director of Path Home Shamanic Arts School, a unique Colorado State-certified occupational school, training shamanic practitioners and teachers. We also provide classes for empowering personal lives through shamanism. Our certification classes are in week-long segments, enabling international participation, and online classes and long-distance shamanic healing sessions are available. Come discover the science of magic in the limitless world of shamanism. www.findyourpathhome.com.
Unwilling to be the government's deadly assassin, gifted psychic Kahara Mitchell went AWOL and ended up buried under rubble in the wake of a great tsunami. She regained consciousness far from Earth on the medical ship of a Daggeronian intergalactic fleet. Has she been rescued or abducted by aliens? The Chalice of Kari, Kahira O'Donnell's latest paranormal science fiction romance, is the passionate story of an Earthwoman and her destined mates, twin kings from another galaxy. Kahara uses her gifts fighting alongside Lords Rom and Ra in a war that will determine the destiny of galaxies. The Chalice of Kari by Kahira O'Donnell is now available at KahiraO'Donnell.com or at Amazon.com.
You're listening to the X-Zone Broadcast Network, www.xzbn.net.
What happened in Benghazi is revealed by Nicholas Genix, author of Obama, Islam, and Benghazi. He informs the American people that President Obama deceived them by advocating a strong foreign policy prior to the 2012 presidential election, and Hillary Clinton supported this deception. As the title infers, there is a connection between Obama, Islam, and Benghazi. Ample evidence informs Americans that Obama's early indoctrination in the Quran developed an affinity for Islam, why the Quran is the source of discontent in many countries, and why the Obama foreign policy deception led to poor military action and caused the loss of American lives in Benghazi. Genix provides 36 questions for the Select Committee on Benghazi to validate if Americans are justified to mistrust President Obama and Hillary Clinton. An overview of Obama, Islam, and Benghazi is presented on the website www.futureofgodamen.com. That's www.futureofgodamen.com. Annie Callahan, dedicated to negotiating a position for Earth within the Daggeronian Coalition, had trained for 3 years to become an Earth ambassador. Yet, the very eve of her arrival at the capital ruling planet, she is claimed as destined mate to an oversized, mating-maddened vamp who swears he will never release her. Lord Astaran, king of the Macian sector, has waited over 900 years for his destined mate. Having found her as an alpha vamp, he is unable to relinquish Annie, virtually holding her hostage until he can claim her. Yet Macians cannot survive without their mate's love. How could he strip her of her citizenship, her ambassadorship, and her freedom and expect to win her heart? With All That I Am by Kahira O'Donnell is the latest book in this exciting series, The Daggeronian Chronicles, guaranteed to keep readers coming back for more. With All That I Am by Kahira O'Donnell is available on Amazon.com and KahiraO'Donnell.com.
Back, everyone. John Moore is our special guest, www.ottawaparanormal.com. How often are you contacted about possible demonic hauntings, and how many turn out to be real, John?
Any given time, I probably get about four or five a week that are people suspecting they have a demon in their house. And of those, I'd say maybe one out of every probably 50 is anything that would be possibly demonic. A lot of the times we're able to dismiss most of them as not even paranormal. So,
How do people take it when you and your team do an investigation and you find a normal or a non-paranormal cause for what's going on, are they a little upset? Do they want it to be paranormal?
There are some that get upset with us because of that, and they do want it to be. But most people, when they actually find out there is a natural cause, they're extremely happy about that because
right.
now they have an answer. They know what's going on. They know that, you know, they're not crazy and that whatever was happening to them is real. And then from there, we can take the steps we have to make it stop.
So what do you look for when investigating for a truly demonic case?
Well, first, obviously, we look for the obvious one, that is there actual paranormal activity occurring? That's the first thing we look for. Because without that, obviously, it can't be a demon, correct?
Sure.
When they've actually established that there is activity, we look at the type of activity that's occurring. We look for, is it negative? Is it focused on one individual? A lot of times, demonic will follow a certain progression where it will start with the children seeing the entity, almost like an imaginary friend. But that imaginary friend will eventually start becoming mean. They'll start attacking, start seeing people getting scratched, hit. You'll see people being pushed into downstairs, things like that. The biggest key that I can think of is that we usually see in every demonic case mm-hmm. is the aversion to religious objects. Like people have reported crosses going missing. In the one case we had, they actually had a picture. It was of the Last Supper that had disappeared. And this is not a small thing. For it to disappear was actually something quite incredible.
How do you explain that? And why would a demon, you know, get rid of a picture?
It's the meaning that it has. You know, it's the religious connotation that it has. That's what they don't like. That's what they rebel against. So they don't like anything like that.
What about holy water? What does holy water do? Because, you know, I'm thinking of the movie The Exorcist, where there was Linda Blair who was levitating off the bed. The bed was levitating at one point. Her head was spinning around. She was spewing pea soup. There was the stench in the room. There was the freezing temperatures. How real is all of this?
That's all Hollywood dramatization, to be quite honest, all of it. I mean, even when we had the woman that looked like she was levitating, mm-hmm. she was only maybe an inch, if that, off the ground. And even then, it may have been, we even look at it and think, are we seeing this?
I see.
Or is there something we're missing? Because obviously, you know, that's... it's rather unnerving to see something like that.
So what is a real exorcism like, John?
A real exorcism is quite intense and it's quite religious. That's the best way I can put it. You have the individual, the possessed, who is there. The priest is there along with people like myself, who would be the lay people. And they would basically, there's a lot of prayers said, signs of the cross with holy oil, holy water, holy salt is used as well. It's pretty well like any other, I want to say like any other, rite you would see in church, except this one involves quite a bit more, a little bit more intensity to it, just based on what's going on, especially if you do end up with the demon attempting to show itself, which happens in a number of cases.
But what about people who may not believe in the religious philosophy that is used for the extrication of demons? For example, a Buddhist. Let's say a Buddhist. I've never heard of a Buddhist being possessed or having, you know, part of their life in infested with demons. Is exorcism only found in religious philosophies where Christ and or Christianity is concerned, or Catholicism is concerned?
No, actually, that's not the only place you see it. Every major religion on Earth actually does have some form of a demon. It may not be dissimilar to the way we see it in Christianity. Mm-hmm. Like the Jewish, they have no formal definition of hell. but they still have the Dybbuk, like in the Dybbuk box. That's their definition. The Islam uses what they call the jinn, although the jinn are almost similar to, I guess, angels and demons, depending on the philosophy you take from the right. from the religion. So these things, they're always out there. There's every single one of them actually has some philosophy on it and their way of dealing with them. It's just the exorcism that we all identify with, especially being from an area where we are largely Christian or Catholic. That's what we've been accustomed to for the most part.
So where do they come from? What is their origin? And why do they stick around?
That's the million-dollar question that, honestly, I don't think anyone has an answer to. Most demonologists that I know of, they look to the Bible as their reference for this. And the biggest one is that they are fallen angels. There was a rebellion in heaven, and that created the rift, which caused God and to send Satan out of heaven and cast into earth.
You know, it seems that Satanism, or in one way or another, is making a comeback. Look on TV, there's that show called Lucifer, where Lucifer is turning into a good guy, and you've got one of the angels who is ticked off at him because by him becoming good, it's upsetting the balance between good and evil. So why do you think that there's so much interest in the paranormal these days, as well as in demonology?
The biggest thing, I just think a lot of it has to do with, again, the fact that it's in pop culture now. The television shows have been doing great with it. On a couple of these shows, and each of these shows is always pushing the boundary, pushing the limit of what they can get away with, what they can do. And so it was a natural progression after the ghosts stopped being interesting that we started seeing. There's one show in particular, I know everyone will know it, where the people on it actually will say they're in possession. It happens almost on a weekly basis, to which it's just, I watched that and I'm just shaking my head going, what are you doing? Why are you doing this? Like, this is so fake. But at the same time, having that out there means that the next show coming along, we need to one up this. So now you're seeing the demons become more prevalent.
Do you think it's time where we start doing a reality check on these shows and letting the people, the viewers, the public know what really goes on? Or do you think a show that actually did a real reality, not a reality that's based on hype and ratings, do you think a show that would be honest would succeed?
I honestly don't think it would, unfortunately. I would love to see it. I honestly would with all of my heart, but I don't think it would, because I always tell people, you know, when you go out and actually see what we do on an investigation, you wouldn't want to watch it. There's a lot, it's rather boring a lot of the time. And for the, we'll say the 1 minute of excitement you actually get during a case, there could be years and years of time where nothing happens.
So people would rather be fed a line of bull than to actually see what really goes on. Sensationalism.
Unfortunately, that's just how it goes. Yeah. It's the entertainment industry, right?
Yeah, but you see, this is just it. People don't realize that what they're watching is entertainment. They think it's real.
Yep, and that's another problem. A lot of these shows, the investigators are real. Like, a lot of these investigators, I've met quite a few of them, and they are real people. They really do know their stuff about the investigation side and all. But it's just when it comes time for the show, that's where the film crews, the editors, all those guys step in, and they have to make what they do interesting. And that's where things get lost in translation.
But how many times can you watch all this night vision, the shaky cameras, the tormenting, the, you know, all the same old, same old, same old? Like, I can't understand what the draw is.
I'm with you on that one. I honestly don't know why they keep doing that, and I would love to see someone come out and do one realistic, follow the investigators, do it the way they do it, but I sadly just don't think it's going to happen. And it would be nice, honestly, to see somebody come up with something new besides just the same old, you know, night vision cameras, thermal imaging, all those things. It'd be nice to see something new. But then again, each time you're bringing new things in, what do you give up?
You know,
and plus the theories behind these things we can't even confirm to begin with. So it's really hard to bring in something new when you can't even confirm the equipment you're actually already using, despite what most people would say after watching the show.
But what is the final outcome supposed to be? Like, what do you do? You discover that ghosts are real. Okay, now what?
That's a good question. once you found out they're real, it's, for me, it would just be, you know, this is something that I've been following my whole life.
Sure.
I've experienced this. And it's just one of those things where it's finally validation.
But in your heart of hearts, you know it's real.
I do. Yes.
What advice?
The reason why I keep doing what I do is because there are others out there that are always afraid of these things.
Sure.
And it's to help them come to terms with what they're experiencing.
What advice would you give to a paranormal team going into an investigation that may be demonic?
Do not, absolutely do not at all invite anything to touch you. Do not invite it to use your energy. Nothing like that. Any invitation you give it like that is giving it power over you. And that's when you can actually become the victim of the demon.
What do these demons look like? Do you have any idea? Have you seen a demon yourself?
I've never seen a demon. They don't take a regular shape. Like, demons, to my knowledge, don't have a full-blown shape like we would expect.
Mm-hmm.
Majority of them, they like to mimic things. Like, they'll appear as we've heard of a couple where they appeared as like almost like hellhounds, you know, dogs with red eyes.
Right.
Shadow entities with red eyes, the Hat Man, obviously. Other times they'll actually appear as like someone who's passed on, like a dead relative, but with one key difference. They cannot fully become the person that they're trying to mimic. There will always be some grotesque giveaway that will tell that it's not perfect.
So what advice would you give anyone who suspects they are suffering from a demonic haunting?
If you're suffering from a demonic haunting, the best thing I would do is contact a demonologist, contact a priest, contact someone like that and tell them, look, we have certain things going on. What would you recommend?
Mm-hmm.
You know, that would be the first thing. I would also say go to the hospital, get checked out. There are plenty of medical conditions that cause this as well. We had one woman who, she actually had a brain aneurysm that was pressing on the left side of her brain, and it was causing her to hallucinate and see the demons. And when she went to the hospital, after we finally convinced her a month later, they literally admitted her instantly.
Wow.
So these are all things like, you know, get yourself medically checked, not because, you know, you want to make sure you're crazy, but you need to make sure because there are natural medical serious conditions that can cause these things. And if there's none of those, then you should talk to definitely a trained demonologist or an extreme paranormal team, someone who's experienced in dealing with these type of things to see what actually is going on.
So how does one become a demonologist? What training is there? What courses are there?
The best way to do it, honestly, is to find a member of the clergy who is trained in it and work with them. Have them train, have them show you what you need to know. This is not something that everybody can go out and do just because they want to. Those of us that do it, we don't do it because we want to. We do it because it's pretty well a calling. You know, like when I had my first demonic case, the OPRI site had been online for about 20 minutes. And we were on like page 50, I think, of a Google search.
Mm-hmm.
And somehow this case came to us and they said it was the first thing that came in when I searched your website. However, nobody else could ever get it to do it. So it's one of those where it's just that when you're called to do this type of thing, it'll happen and you'll find everything you need that way.
What's your take on Ouija boards?
Absolutely not a fan. Seen too many cases that have actually involved them as a starting point. So I know there are people out there that work with them regularly. We have an occult specialist on our team that works with them regularly, but there are so many people that are not trained in how to use them. They don't know what they're doing and they get themselves into trouble.
But if they're that dangerous, John, how come they're sold in toy stores?
That's just one, because it is technically a game. Originally the Ouija board started out as a game. It's become a more nefarious item now, Mm-hmm. But a game, you know, it started out once upon a time as a game for kids.
Well, what would happen, John, if I took an 11 by 17 sheet of paper and I put every letter of the alphabet and I put yes and no in each corner, and then on the bottom I put numbers, and I made myself a little planchette. Would that be a Ouija board?
Yes, it would. That's still a Ouija board. Doesn't matter if you buy it in a store or if you make it yourself. The board is still the board.
Who do you find uses Ouija boards most? Kids, teenagers, or adults?
I'd have to say probably it's about equal between the teenagers and adults, honestly. Because you do get a lot of the adults that watch some of these more out there paranormal shows, and they'll say, hey, I want to try that. Right?
Hey, John, you and I have to take our final break for this hour. Please stand by. Great talking to you. Thanks very much for taking time out of your busy schedule to join us here. We really appreciate it, my friend.
No problem. Thank you.
ExoNation, our guest this hour, John Moore. He's lead investigator and the founder of the Ottawa Paranormal Research and Investigations, and their website is www.ottawaparanormal.com. John and I return as we wrap up this hour here in the X Zone on the other side of this break. And don't forget, you can always send an email to xzone@xzoneradiotv.com or xzoneradio.com. And John and I will be back wrapping this hour up. Demonology, exorcism, and much more. Don't go away.
Little children aren't the only ones afraid of the dark. Millions of soldiers return from war zones with PTSD, anger, frustration, fear, and loneliness, much of which surfaces during the darkness of the night. You have the chance to change the lives of these American heroes. Songs and Stories for Soldiers.us provides free MP3 players for these men and women. With a list of 3 million songs in 16 different styles, 100,000 audiobooks, and 30,000 old-time radio programs, every veteran can find something to soothe and comfort them at no cost. All our players contain an 8-hour audio program designed to help veterans fall asleep. With 1,500 plus vets now participating, it's our goal to deliver 10,000 audio players this year. Go to our website at songsandstoriesforsoldiers.us. Help us help a veteran make it through the night.
I am Dr. Carl O'Helvey, founder, president of a new cancer foundation focusing on evidence-based physical, mental, and spiritual interventions, including natural cancer cures, prayer, meditation, affirmations, nutrition, and other related holistic cancer prevention and cure modalities. These are used in cancer education, research, and financing care. I ask for your help to continue this important work by donating at www.holisticcancerfoundation.com.
You're listening to the X Zone Broadcast Network, www.xzbn.net.
If you enjoy reading a good mystery with a touch of the paranormal, then you'll love From Out of the Woodwork by William S. Peckham. Sean Kennedy, a Toronto contractor, buys derelict houses, guts them, and turns them into multifamily dwellings. When Sean buys 29 Livery Lane, a century house in ruins, and starts the renovation, the house fights back. He is visited by ghosts of owners past. His visions are triggered by touching an oak mantle, reading a faded letter, opening an old locket, or opening a brand new casket in the basement. These visions will take you on a trip across southern Ontario from Niagara Falls to Toronto to Kingston. From Out of the Woodwork is now available in paperback and on your favorite electronic reader. To order your copy of From Out of the Woodwork, go to www.williamspeckham.com. That's
www.williamspeckham.com.
Thank you.
Exonation, John Moore is our special guest this hour. www.ottawaparanormal.com. First of all, John, I want to thank you so much for joining us. It's been a great pleasure talking to you. What advice or what words of wisdom do you have for the listening audience of the X-Zone tonight? What would you like to share with them?
I guess the biggest thing I'd like to say is for anyone out there who's listening who has an interest in the paranormal, go out, do your own research into it. Don't just rely on what you see on TV. There's plenty of resources out there in parapsychology magazines, books from Lloyd Orbach, as well as many other well-known parapsychologists. And if you are interested in demonology, there's plenty out there by different demonologists as well. So I would absolutely say look into those things rather than what you see on TV.
How long does it take someone to become a demonologist like yourself?
Honestly, you're always learning.
Yes, sir.
That's the thing. Every demonologist is different. Like, I honestly don't look at myself as a demonologist. Like, I work with a old Roman Catholic bishop, and I'm always learning new things from him, and he's always learning new things too. So you can never really say that you're truly a demonologist. You're always going to be someone who's learning new things, because the enemy's always out there, and they're always coming up with new tricks for us.
Do you have any idea when the first recorded case of demonic or demons were here in Canada?
I do not, unfortunately.
Is Ottawa very haunted?
We have quite a bit of activity going on in the nation's capital here. If you go back when Ottawa was first founded, it was rather a very rough and tough town. That was back when it was called Bytown. So
right.
There was a lot of nasty things that have happened. We do have quite a few sites around the city that are very, very haunted.
I understand Sir John A. MacDonald is seen walking the halls of on Capitol Hill in the Parliament buildings.
I've heard that rumor too, but yeah. Unfortunately I've been never able to get them to let me come in there and take a look, if you know what I mean.
They don't have a sense of humor, do they?
Oh, not really.
And yet look who we elect.
I kind of figured once he got in, I might have a better chance, but I guess he's a little busy working on getting one of his bills put through or something.
I guess. Hey, listen, John, it's been great talking to you. Thank you very much for sharing your time with us. And let our listeners know how they can get a hold of you and find out more about you and what you and your group does.
Well, thanks for having me, Rob. It's been a great time. For anyone who is looking to reach me, the best way is through the Ottawa Paranormal website, which is ottawaparanormal.com. On there, you'll find links to all of our social media, our email. Everything is all right there for you.
And once again, Exonation, that's ottawaparanormal.com. Hey, John, thanks so much for joining us. It's been a great pleasure, and I look forward to the next time you and I meet back here in the X-Zone or we come to Ottawa to see you.
You too, Rob. Looking forward to it.
Take care of myself. Take care, my friend. X-Zone Nation, my guest this hour has been John Moore. He is the lead investigator and founder of Ottawa Paranormal Research and Investigations, and as I said, his website is ottawaparanormal.com. Well, that's it for tonight, X-Zone Nation. I'll be back tomorrow night at 8 o'clock as once again we cross the time-space continuum to this place that I call the X-Zone. It's a place where people dare to believe and dare to be heard. It's a place where fact is fiction and fiction is reality. And we come to you Monday through Friday right here on the X-Zone Broadcast Network, on the Mutual Broadcast Network, on the Talkstar Radio Network, and of course our friends in Europe on Radio X. So until tomorrow night, remember, always keep your eyes to the sky and your heart to the light. Good night, everyone.